Would you pray with me, please? Lord, I come to you now, such a thankful, humbled under shepherd. Lord, this is the day we celebrate as your birthday. Help us to never lose sight of the Christ that defines Christmas. Help us, Lord, to seek your face and your will in all that we do, all the time. To remember that the reason why the world stops and takes notice this day has nothing to do with Santa Claus, presents, Christmas trees, lights, holiday parties, or anything else. It is because the God of heaven loved we, his created people, enough to send his Son into this world, this fallen world, to live and to die out of love for his children, that we would live forevermore in harmony with you. And all of God's children said, amen and amen. Well, this morning, I say to you first and foremost, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. And I ask you on this Christmas morning, on the day that we celebrate Jesus' birthday, to look around you. Look around. And I ask you, what do you see? Right here, right now, I'm asking you literally to look around. And I'm asking you, what do you see? What do you see around you? I see Romans 16. On a Sunday where we'll close out a series in which we have walked through, for the better part of a year, the entire book, verse by verse, of Romans. I say to you as an under-shepherd and a blessed man that I see Romans 16. I see the gifts and the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I pray that before we're done this morning, you will too. I've asked that we intentionally come together as a full family, a faith family, but also in our structured biological families, that we are all here tight together. Because whether you're my little guy, Gideon, 5 years old, or if you're one of our senior saints, I ask you to look around. What do you see? Do you see brothers and sisters in Christ? Do you see the very glory of God? Do you see grace lived out? Do you see the gospel coming alive? What do you see? I pray that each and every one of us will know that we know that we know that Christ lives. We celebrate Christmas not because he lived once, but because he lives. Our God reigns. This morning, I want to walk through with you Romans 16. And I just ask you to compare in your mind's eye or in your heart. We spent a lot of time in Romans. And if you've been with us, you know that it is the Bible's theological layout of the gospel itself. We've seen a greeting where God has told us that he loves us. We're told of the offense of sin and the need for sin to be addressed, that there can be no good news without sin being addressed, that Jesus alone is the only way of salvation, that unless we're justified by him, we can never know eternal life. We're told that this life will be one of a constant purification process, that we're going to be sanctified all the way through, and that God is in charge of everything, every dust mite he has in place. And we've learned over the last number of weeks, as we've come to the close of the book of Romans, that there is a living component, that we are obligated to live as children of the King, that we are obligated to live out our faith. Not perfectly, but passionately. Last week, I spent a good part of the week in the hospital. And you know that I meant to be here with you, and it was my intention to preach our sermon from last week. I had the highest excitement over the thought of preaching the closing half of Romans 15, for there we saw Paul's heart for God. We saw the heart of a missionary, the call for each and every one of us. But it was clearly God's will that Pastor Mike would share that with you. And It became clear to me why this week. You see, I had my heart set on the second half of Romans 15. I felt that was my verse. That was my passage. And he's made clear to me that no, it's Romans 16 that better fits me. And it's my gift and my honor, my privilege to share with you this morning. Not only as a man blessed, but as an under-shepherd blessed. And so I want to ask you to walk with me this morning. We're going to go much more quickly than we normally would, because I want people like my little guys, Silas and Gideon, and everyone here to understand the simplicity of the beauty of the gospel gifts and glory that we see. You see, on this Christmas day, it's my prayer that you'll walk away seeing Romans 16 and understanding that there is a gospel gift in the fact that we have a gospel family of faith. Again, I ask you to look around. What do you see? The gospel has a gift in its truth and its love. And the gospel brings us the ultimate gift of Jesus Christ and the glory of God. Walk with me now, if you have your Bibles, through Romans 16. And let us take a journey with Paul. I ask you up front to bear in mind that Romans 16, scholars will tell us, brings hardly any direct teaching. It is not a chapter that has what the rest of Romans has been chock full of, direct didactic theological instruction. You don't have in Romans 16 the do's and the don'ts. You don't have the deep theological doctrines of the faith. And yet I say to you this morning, I believe that this is one of the most beautiful chapters in all the Bible. I would say to you, and scholars would agree, that this is perhaps the most beautiful look at the heart of Paul for people. And we as God's people should have a heart for people. It is one of the most beautiful expressions of the gospel message lived out, not in the classroom, but in the community. Not amongst statues and statutes, but among citizens and real life people. Let's read, if you will. And I'm going to walk through a number of verses and then come back later and we'll unpack it. God's word says in Romans chapter 16, I'm going to read verses 1 through 16, and then I'm going to pick up and continue with verses 21 through 24. And I want you to think about this beautiful family of faith. What we're going to see is Paul speaking to his family of faith, some of which he knew intimately and some he never met. You see, it's not like the way we define family, where you've got to have the same DNA, that you've got to have the same last name, or somehow through the family tree make a connection. All we have to do is have the same daddy to recognize one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. Listen to how Paul brings this most beautiful and powerful book in all the Bible, perhaps, to a close, and ask yourself, how important is family? I commend to you our sister, Phoebe, a servant of the church in Caesarea. I ask you to receive her in the Lord in a way worthy of the saints, and to give her any help she may need from you, for she has been a great help to many people, including me. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus. They risked their lives for me. Not only I, but all the churches of the Gentiles are grateful to them. Greet also the church that meets at their house. Greet my dear friend, Epaphroditus, who was the first convert to Christ in the whole province of Asia. Greet Mary, who worked very hard for you. Greet Andronikos and Eunios, my relatives, who have been in prison with me. They are outstanding. They are outstanding among the apostles. And they were in Christ before I was. Greet Amplias, whom I love in the Lord. Greet Orbanos, our fellow worker in Christ. And greet my dear friend, Stachus. Greet Apelles. He was tested and approved in Christ. Greet those who belong to the household of Aristobulus. Greet Herodian, my relative. Greet those in the household of Narcissus who are in the Lord. Greet Tryphena and Tryphosa, those women who work hard in the Lord. Beautiful side note, their names are dainty and delicate in English. They work hard in the Lord. Amen. Greet my dear friend Perses, another woman who has worked very hard in the Lord. Greet my dear friend Rufus. Love Rufus. Chosen in the Lord. One translation says Rufus, a choice man in the Lord. It's all we know about Rufus. Love Rufus. And Rufus's mother, who has been like a mother to me too. Bless all you moms that love without walls. Greet Asinucritus, Phlegon, Hermes, Petrobus, Hermas, and the brothers with them. That whole clan. Bless them all and greet them. Timothy, my fellow worker, sends his greetings to you. As do Lucius, Iasphon, and Sopipatros, my relative. Greetings to you, greetings to you, greetings to you from all of them. Tertius, who wrote down this letter, he too greets you in the Lord. Gaius, whose hospitality I and the whole church here enjoy, sends you his greetings too. And Erastus, who is the city's director of public works and our brother, Quartus, sends you their greetings as well. Say, Pastor Jeff, what's up with all that? Do you hear the love there? Do you note something a little different than what you get in the Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, humdrum, run around the world, this rat race that we live in? Do you sense a different tone? Brothers and sisters, I ask you, look around the room. What do you see? The very gospel gift of a family of faith. If you were to take now and pull the names out, let me tell you what we just saw. The extraordinary ordinary. You see, these are the ordinary people of Christ. And Paul loved them so much to know them and to list them by name, that God in his sovereignty would see to it that the ordinary would be known forever as the extraordinary, not because of their namesake, but because of their King. because of their Savior, because of their daddy. Listen to the descriptions that were inherent in that passage. We have commendable servant brothers and sisters, great helpers of the multitudes, fellow workers, true co-laborers in Christ, inspirationally courageous, no matter what risk takers, selfless lovers of God and man, church planters and lay leaders within the body of Christ. Dear friends, I mean real friends, the kind that would die for each other. Groundbreaking leaders, the first followers, the ones that would stand alone if that's what it took for Christ. The very hard workers whose faithful blood, sweat, and tears moved mountains of people. The persecuted and the imprisoned, the martyrs and the missionaries, the outstanding apostles, the standout sent ones, the best of the best, the tested and the approved ministry partners, the people you can count on. Hear that. The people you can count on. This is our family of faith. Not just any family, but the family of faith. Sharing and spreading both the love and the influence of God for the kingdom and the glory of God. God's hand-chosen saints. God's hand-chosen saints. Those that have been called and equipped by God Himself. I say to you on Christmas morning as we look at the gospel that one of the greatest gifts and one of the greatest things that brings glory to God is the family of faith that we are known to be. I brought a quilt with me. Paul talked about the very first Christian in Asia, the first convert. He talks overall in that passage about the beauty and the blessing of the family of faith. Some that are intimately known to one another and some that have never met, but yet know that they are a family. That picture has always been that of a quilt to me, a quilt without a pattern, a quilt without any duplication, one that brings in the uniqueness of each and every human being in the body of Christ. And I believe every local church, every local body should look like a quilt. And Aunt Mary Malley, the first baptized soul at the bridge, said, "Pastor Jeff, I hear you talking, and this quilt, this is what I see. Can I give this to you as a gift? I can't do a lot, but I can quilt. And what you described as the family of God sounded an awful lot like this." The original hangs in our church office and always will, or somewhere of prominence that we will always remember the gift. See, Christ came to live and to die, that we would live in part together as a family of faith, that our lights would shine individually and together. One of the greatest gifts we have this Christmas is one another. I learned this personally and powerfully this week. As I was laid up and unable to move, you loved me and my family. I watched my family love me. I ask you on this Christmas morning, to the glory of God, through the work of Jesus Christ, to cherish your family. Cherish the family that you have at home and cherish your family of faith. And I say this to you without apology. It is this standard of a family that we will champion. It is this light that we will shine, and it is this bar that we will raise to the glory of God. For there are many professed faiths, many professed families that are dysfunctional, and I challenge you and I ask you to never settle for the dysfunctional, devilish families that would not hold God's glory and His word up as the standard. We ought not apologize for loving one another more than people think is normal. We ought not apologize for going further than others think is normal or politically correct. We ought not ever apologize for holding up the standards and the glory of God. For we are in part a family for the purpose of championing Christ, to show the world the difference between being in the crowd and being a part of His church. Not a church, but His church. His church is a family of faith, defined in large part by the characteristics we've just seen. In this hodgepodge of ordinary people, these are not the Hall of Fame saints. These are the average, everyday saints. I hear so often that the call that we lift up as we read God's word is that of the extraordinary and the exceptional. No, this is the very definition of what it is to be a child of God. Those that say, "Yes, Lord," with all our hearts, whose lives are His, who see Christmas and Easter not as holidays, but as defining parts of our life as we lift up our King. I tell you that one of the other great gifts of Christmas, the gospel gift, is that of truth and love. You see, in verse 16, we're told, "Greet one another with a holy kiss," and that all the churches of Christ send their greetings. We have a time that we call share the love. Our intention as a body, as a family, as a church, is to love one another and to get closer than people are comfortable with out in the world. We don't greet one another with holy kisses anymore, but we hug as often as we can. We care. When you ask how you're doing, we lean in to hear the answer. When somebody's going through something, we want to pray with and love on one another. We want to bear each other's burdens. That's real. Truth and love says this should not be the exception, but the norm. You know, we're not something special when we compare ourselves to the Bible. We're just being children of God, and we shouldn't be ashamed of that. We should thank the Lord for our family of faith, and we ought to show the world what it is to truly be adopted. We ought to live like brothers and sisters. And I thank you that I get to under-shepherd a people, in large part, who are committed to being this quilt, to being that light, that are showing the world. I sat in a hospital bed for 4 days, and the rooms next to me were impacted by the people of the Bridge. I know that I know that I know that God did a work in 2 people in rooms next to me simply because some of you came and loved not just your pastor, but people. You went and you prayed. You touched. You showed Jesus to people who are not accustomed to the Christ of relationship, simply the boxed Jesus of religion. I'm so thankful that we are a family. I'm also thankful that God has shown us the gift of truth and love for both warning and winning. Listen to what He says in verses 17 through 20. "I urge you, brothers, I urge you with urgency to keep your eye on, to mark those who cause divisions and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teachings you have learned." God tells us in this beautiful picture of love and family to keep your eye on those who cause division. Keep your eye on those who are making problems in the family. Do not let division stand where the liars and those that would take you away from Christ or would pull others away. Don't let them get away with it. Out of love, mark them. Keep your eye on them and have nothing to do with them. You don't debate. You don't get into deep discussion. You have nothing to do with them. You keep your eye on them. This is the very essence of a wolf. It's not out of the ordinary that in the midst of a loving passage, the love would continue with a warning that says truth matters. He goes and he says, For such people are not serving our Lord Christ, but their own appetites. By smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the minds of naive people. Listen to what he said in the second half of verse 17. He said, keep away from them. Simple, straightforward. Keep away from them. For such people are not serving our Lord Christ, but their own appetites. By smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the minds of naive people. Verse 19, everyone has heard about your obedience. He says, all of you, praise God, all of the churches, they've heard of your obedience. So I am full of joy over you. I share in Paul's glory. I'm so blessed to watch so many of you blossom. We're all works in progress, and we will be till the day we die. Not a soul is done till we're done. Anybody tells you different, run. Watch out. But oh, what a blessing it is to watch us bloom and blossom as a family of faith. Paul says, so I am full of joy over you, but, and you say, oh, this is where you get to be pastor again, right? Yeah. But I want you to be wise about what is good and innocent about what is evil. It's important that we are wise about what is good and totally innocent about what is evil. That's why we don't tinker with, we don't flirt with, we don't dip our toe in. We don't kind of measure it out and see, well, it's not so bad. I want you to be totally innocent of what is evil. And here's one of the greatest promises in all the Bible, verse 20. The God of peace. The God of peace. Some of you will struggle with this next phrase. Some of your friends struggle with it. You say, how can a God of love have wrath and also see to it that his holiness and his justice will reign? Here he says, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. Don't miss that. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. Here we're told the very declaration. Not only does truth tell us to watch out, but truth tells us we will win. Yes, we will advance on our knees. Those of us who pray and live by faith, we do our battle on our knees, and the world laughs and scoffs, but we will stand in truth. And God's word says, where he could crush Satan all by himself, he promises that we will soon see Satan crushed under the feet of his children. It's worth it. We win. Truth and love equips us to worship. It warns us and it promises us that we win. We now close with the last three verses, 25, 26, and 27. This is known as a doxology in Scripture. This is where, and it happens in multiple cases across this word, where the writer of Scripture, God, just bursts into praise. We become overwhelmed in the close of who God is. Here at the end of Romans, Paul brings us now to this place where we thank God for what he has done through Jesus Christ. On this Christmas day, to see the gospel's gift and the gospel's glory, it's to recognize who we are in Jesus the Christ. God's word says, now to him who is able to establish you by my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings, by the command of the eternal God, so that, here's the cause, so that, here's the purpose, so that all nations might believe and obey him, that all nations would come to faith and obey, to the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus the Christ. Amen and amen and amen. I celebrate Christmas with you today in the warmth of my gospel gift of a family of faith, standing on truth and love that says, watch out for those who cause division and take you away from both the gospel of Christ and the family of faith. And the promise that says we win and that the God of peace will soon crush Satan under our feet. And I stand with you in awe of Almighty God. The mystery and the majesty of Creator God, whose love has come to us through the birth and the death and proven through the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. May we never, ever lose our passion for the promises of Christmas, Christ's day. Amen and amen. Would you please pray with me? Oh, Father God, I thank you so much. As one who deserves nothing and has received the treasure of heaven, your Son, Lord, that you would give him life, that he would die, that we would know life forevermore with you. Lord, we love you. We trust you. We come as broken sinners, deserving nothing but your wrath. Undeserved, and by the grace through faith, we have been saved and now live sanctified day by day, asking you to purify us more and more. Make us more like you. Draw us closer to you. Give us hatred for the sin that we once loved, and give us love for the ways of God that we once rejected. Give us peace, I pray, in remembering that you are sovereign over all, that your providence reigns, that not a dust mite is out of space, that even in the midst of difficulties, that you use diseases and difficulties, trials, and times that just simply go beyond what we can understand. All of that is a part of your purpose to bring glory to you as we, your children, draw closer, living out lives of imperfect but passionate pursuits of your will. Lord, help us not to seek a to-do list or a resume. It's our prayer that we will be, and that our relationship will grow with you. Father, help us to see the wolves. Help us to love the family. And help us to be forever in awe of your majesty. In Jesus' name we pray, as a family of faith. Amen and amen.